Tonight on Access TV, it's Gotham Comedy Live. Get ready to laugh with Tommy Pope, Damien Lemon, George Gallo, Brian Scott McFadden. This week's host, Heather McDonald. Gotham Comedy Live, all happening right now. Ladies and gentlemen, Heather McDonald!
Hi, you guys! Thank you so much. Thank you so much. I love coming to New York. I live in LA. And, you know, a lot of people complain about having to travel all the time when you're in this business. But I have to admit, I kind of like it because I figured out a way to make it a lot more fun for myself. Ladies, I suggest you do the same. When I go through security, I like to leave a little quarter in my pocket. Have you ever tried it? It's kind of nice. Let me just tell you what happens. You get like the kind of dykey TSA officer in the too tight of an outfit. She's like, can you come here, ma'am? Can you? I'm like, oh God, I don't know, can I? She's like, I need to swipe right here. Okay, all right. Swipe, okay. Is that an underwire bra? I don't know, is it? It's just nice to be touched, you know? Especially during like a long like LA to New York 5-hour flight, you know, because I've been married 13 years, so I have to pay people to touch me, and I have been married 13 years. Thank you. Happily for six. But you know what, people? I made a promise to God, and I'm going to heaven, and the rest of you can just fuck off, all right? I don't want to be like my friends who are divorced and dating 28-year-old guys, screwing them every other weekend when their husbands take their three kids. Who wants a life like that? I mean, that would be kind of nice, obviously. But no, like I said, I am Catholic, and I am going to heaven. So there you go, people. No, when I got here this morning, I did book myself a massage because that's like my little treat, and the guy was so good. He worked out all the knots, you know, in my breasts. And oh, so good. And then he said to me, he's like, you should be getting massages on a weekly basis because you're still just carrying a lot of stress, you know, in your vagina. And I'm like, all right. I had no idea there's so much tension down there, Raul, but thank you for working it out for me. Appreciate that. The problem is with my husband, we have three kids, and he's very cheap. And let me just tell you something, ladies. If you have a cheap husband or a cheap boyfriend, there is a silver lining. If your husband is like mine and insists that you share a fountain drink at a Panda Express, because why would you buy another? It's like $1.73. I mean, no one's going to say anything. What, he's so fucking stupid? You're going to go, no one's going to say anything when you go up and refill it, you dumb bitch. Just do it. So if he insists that you share a fountain drink, there's an excellent chance that he will never be spending a grand on a hooker. I'm just saying, ladies. Thank you. Let's look on the bright side. Let's keep these families together. Can we do that? Can we do that for America? Can we just do one nice thing? The other thing is, the other day we went to Chipotle. Just do something fun. Thank you. It's totally good. Just something fun to do as a family, you know, on a Saturday. And my husband had two coupons, but you're only supposed to use one per family. So we had to pretend like we weren't a family. I swear to fucking God. I am not kidding. I went with my daughter. We waited for like a stranger or two to come in line between us. Then we sat at two different tables. And then halfway through the burrito bowl, my son forgot. He tried to talk to my daughter. And she's like, no, Drake, we're not supposed to know each other. What Dad did was illegal. He's going to go to jail. We're going to lose the house. I'm like, nice childhood memory that we're giving this girl. Seriously. Then last weekend, true story, my husband goes, so this box of condoms are about to expire, so you want to do something about it or what? I'm like, I don't know. I'm so horny right now. I don't think I can control myself when you talk to me. He's so sexy like that. I'm like, you know, we got some half and half in the fridge that's about to expire, so you want to make a pot of coffee and drink that while we bone? Because I don't want to waste anything at all in this house ever. So So we have three kids, and I guess we're done having kids. I mean, we probably should be, but, you know, it's like, if my friends get pregnant or I see little babies, you know, I get kind of jealous. Or if I see that show, I didn't know I was pregnant. You know that show on the Discovery Channel? When I see that show, I get jealous. I'm sitting in my bed watching it and going, well, why can't I be fat enough to have a cramp, go to the hospital, and come home with a baby? I mean, think about it, ladies. How great would that be? You don't have to worry about, like, God, am I too old, or can we afford it, or do I have to give up alcohol or take the retard test? You didn't know you were pregnant, okay? And everybody's happy for you after the fact. You just have to explain what happened. You're like, what happened? You're like, well, one day I had to take a big shit. Turned out my shit had a face. Here's my baby. It's just a little beautiful baby. It's a gift from God. The Lord works in mysterious ways. God. And so I mentioned before I'm Catholic, and I send my kids to Catholic school. Let me tell you something. When you send your kids to Catholic school or Christian school, and you're a bit of a lapsed Catholic as I am, I'll admit it. You know, I go to church when it's important, like if I have a really cute outfit to wear. But when you send them to Catholic school, it's like having a bunch of little narcs running around the house. It's like, oh, you said a bad word. You broke one of the Ten Commandments. It's like, oh, fuck you. Shut up, you narc. Go read your Bible on your iPad. Then my son, my middle child, he's 11. He's my least favorite. I'm just saying, not forever, just for right now, really fucking annoying, okay? So during Lent, he's like, Mom, what are you going to give up for Lent? What are you going to give up? I'm like, I don't know. You know, I never gave up anything. And he's like, I know what you should give up, Mom. It's my teacher said it has to be something that you have every single day that's a true sacrifice. I know, Mom, you should give up Chardonnay. I know. I'm like, Jesus does not expect you to give up your medication. You're so stupid. Why we're paying for the school. Annoying. And I get a lot of shit when I'm living in LA because from these other Hollywood moms because I vaccinate my children. That's right. I don't want them to get polio, so fuck off. I mean, seriously, what is the alternative? Homeschooling them? I'd rather shoot myself in the head. I don't think anything is worse than that. So I vaccinate them, and I'm at this Hollywood party, and the word gets around that I vaccinate my kids, and all these mothers are like, oh my God, Heather, I can't believe you vaccinate your children. You have no idea how bad that is for them. There's horrible chemicals in it, and it can really change their personality. And have you looked into a gluten-free diet, have you? Because wheat's the new enemy. It really is. I'm like, hey, hypocrite, I think I know how you lost your baby weight, okay? And it wasn't doing downward dog unless you were sniffing lines of cocaine off the wood floor. Fucking loser. Like, how annoying. Ugh. And you know what's really annoying is that every actress, when they have a baby, acts like they're the only person in the world that's ever had a baby. I'm like, no, a couple other people have done it. Really not that interesting. And we had Drew Barrymore on Chelsea Lately recently, and she had a baby, and now she's pregnant again. She was on, and she's like, oh my God, no, seriously, you guys. I'm so incredibly blessed. I am. I can't believe it. Mm-hmm. It's just such a miracle. It's so surreal. I mean, seriously, it's a miracle. Much like the movie I did, Miracle, which was about whales being trapped under the sea in Alaska, which was in the 80s, and such a special movie. Please, I hope you guys see it. And please get my wine. I have my own winery. It's just a blend of Pinot Grigios and Merlots. And it's totally fine that I drink now, because I went to rehab, but that was when I was 9, and it was for cocaine. So it's totally fine, totally fine that I drink now. But seriously, you guys, I'm so incredibly blessed. Thank you so much. I love being here at Gotham. I love being in New York City. I'm seriously, it's so special. I'm like, fuck. Ugh. Oh my God. I'm excited to be out here. I'm excited to be in New York. I'm gonna go out dancing later. Ladies, you know when you dance all night long, why is it that you can dance all night long and the minute you walk to your car, you're like, I have Parkinson's. I am now crippled. Thanks. Happy 35th birthday, but I'm never walking again. You guys, thank you so much. I had a great time. We have great comics coming up. Stay tuned. We have four amazing guys.
Stay tuned for more laughs on Access TV, live from the Gotham Comedy Club in New York City. Tommy Pope is taking the stage when we return. Welcome back to the Access TV presentation of Gotham Comedy Live. More laughs happening right now.
Oh my God, this next comedian we're bringing up, he just killed it at the Montreal Comedy Festival. Please give it up for Tommy Pope.
All right, New York. You animals. Animals, all of you. I'm gonna get this out. I don't trust people that can nap in public. I feel like they haven't been abused enough in their lifetime. Everybody says New York is a city that never sleeps, hasn't taken the L train during rush hour. It's like adult daycare. Like everybody just got done crushing a carton of milk. Now they're all cock bobbing on each other like toddlers, like. Who lets their guard down during rush hour? How are you not constantly afraid someone's gonna put their genitals directly on your forehead? I had two older brothers. I could be in a locked tent in the middle of the desert. I still have one eye half open for balls. I'm always on ball watch. You animals. My girlfriend has a kill switch, I think. She powers down like a PlayStation when she's gonna go to bed. Just out. I'm like, that was 3 seconds. She falls asleep like the drummer of a Chuck E. Cheese band. Fucking out. It pisses me off. I like drugs. All right. Listen, we've already covered your animals. Let's stop it. But I feel like the drug dealers are working together with the sandwich bag makers. Because normal people, like you and I, never have a good reason to use a 1-inch resealable Ziploc bag. I've never eaten 99% of a sandwich and got to that one center morsel like, this fucking thing. In case you go to the zoo later. Ziploc getting all street smart. I love when people say that. It's usually when they want to warn you, like some fucking lunatic's on his way over. Like, look, guys, shh, shh, close the door. Andrew's coming over, all right? He's not book smart. But he's really street smart. Bullshit. What I actually hear is he didn't technically finish grade school, but he knows how to get 10 Oxycontins onto an airplane. Street smarts aren't real. They're just not real. If they were, the smartest people on earth would be the homeless. They'd be the go-to guy in the community anytime you had an issue. Like, hey, mom, I think I have a lump in my neck or something. She'd be like, well, get in the minivan, hon. We're gonna go see Slick Rick under the Brooklyn Bridge. The van pulls up and Slick Rick's wearing a pair of goggles made out of powdered donuts. And he's like, Jesus, put a gummy bear in my belly button.
fuck are you talking about? We just have a question. And he's like, oh, fair enough. Step forward. Does it hurt when I put pressure on it? You're fine. Take two of these Oxycontins. My landlord's an alcoholic. Apparently he's here. No, he is a full-blown alcoholic. And judging by the downstairs bathroom, he's also an amateur drywall boxer. His name is Dad. Real miserable son of a bitch growing up. The guy was miserable. The only joy he found in life was when the Dallas Cowboys were losing. And he couldn't say I love you to his son. So as we got older, I got smart about it. Instead of saying I love you at the end of a phone conversation, I just go, hey, Dad, the Cowboys are losing. And he's like, I know, son. The Cowboys are losing, too. Thanks. Scared to be depressed, because that runs in the family, too. But also because of the commercials. Why are the commercials to treat depression so goddamn depressing? The music's like... And then they show pictures of depressed people doing what they do best, lying on a kitchen floor, petting multiple animals for some fucking reason. And then comes a voiceover from creepy witch doctor. It's just like,
who does depression hurt?
Everyone.
Where does depression hurt?
Everywhere.
Pick it up, psycho. Trying to save my cousin. She might as well just come out and go, hey, come here, stupid.
Do you know what's overrated? Breathing.
So stop.
Do you know what'd be over then?
Everything.
My brother's bipolar. Anybody here bipolar? Yeah, nobody usually claps to that. Sometimes you hear, because that's how they whistle. One time my brother said the F word so violently he pulled a calf muscle. It was a fun Easter. You know when you tell a little kid it's time for bed and he's not ready for that and he does that little wig out where he throws his legs and his arms out and arches his back?
And he's like, but I'm not ready for bed yet. I don't want to go to bed. I didn't even finish my chocolate milk and there's so much time left in the day. And there's at least, I was up later last night and I don't want to go to bed. I don't want to go to bed.
It was just like that. Except he went, fuck you! Fuck me! I'm scared I'm gonna be crazy because I already panic in normal situations. Do you know how your mind panic when you try and hold a yawn in an important conversation? Like a job interview? And the guy's like, well, let me tell you why we think you're a perfect fit for this company. And you're just like, and the whole time your mind's like Mel Gibson in Braveheart, like, oh! That's how my mind panics in every social situation. Like when a guy asks for directions at a red light, I'm more concerned with the light changing and taking shit from the stranger behind me than the actual directions themselves, so I give this poor guy some chopped up version of the truth and I just bail on him. I was like, what, 1095?
Yeah, you just want to go down like 3 blocks. You're gonna see a Home Depot. It's gonna be in your left, but you want to take a right. You're gonna see like a gas station. This used to be a gas. I don't know. I gotta get out of here. I just fucking
turning down alleys that I would never turn down just so I don't have to meet this guy at the next goddamn red light. And then 10 minutes later, I'm that guy. Like,
do you know how to get back to 95?
Thank you guys. That's my time. Thank you so much.
Stay tuned for more laughs on Access TV, live from the Gotham Comedy Club in New York City. Damien Lemon is taking the stage when we return.
Okay, so this next comic you've seen on MTV's Guy Code, I love that show. Please give it up for Damien Lemon.
You. All right. You. All right. Oh. All right. Good looking out. Ah. Corn is the 9/11 of vegetables. Could never forget. That's some shit I tweeted when I was high. Right. Profound though, if you're on the right strain, that was deep. You know? That's the beauty of Twitter and marijuana, right? Go together like ice cream and cake, you know? Because you know, like when you get to that point in your high where you feel like every thought you have is brilliant, you feel like everything you think should have quotes around that shit. That's when Twitter's good. You're like, oh shit, wait a minute. These heads ain't ready. Hold on, let me get to this laptop. Crack your knuckles, like, oh shit. Porno wouldn't be shit without fast forward. Tweet! It's true. This is true. It's true. That's true, man. You don't want to see how they met. You know, this ain't a romantic comedy. I'm trying to get right to the action. You're trying to beat your dick before work. Come on. I ain't got too much time. Masturbation, that was on demand before on demand. I want my pleasure now. You look like you masturbate a little bit. A little bit, right? I could tell. You got the posture. But how you doing? Don't you hate it when you beating your dick, right? And you gotta stop short to let the video buffer, you know, like you gotta. Cause you be sitting there like, ah, shit. You was too excited, like, ah, damn it. And you're stealing Wi-Fi from the person upstairs, so now you upset, you catch a glimpse of yourself in the mirror with your laptop in one hand, your dick in the other hand. Like, 2J, get your shit together. Come on. Anyway. It's good to be. I'm New York. I'm from New York. You know, I'm a New Yorker. Yeah. All right. Yeah. That's what's up. Where I live now, there's a lot of white people in my neighborhood. I won't say I live in a white neighborhood because that'd sound like I gave up and shit. You know, but. Yeah. I'm a turn it, you know, it's like reverse gentrification. But what I've noticed is white people have taken over the pit bull. I don't know if you noticed that, but like, you know, y'all have got that. That's your dog now. Y'all call it by its ancestral name, the pit bull terrier. Like, wow, okay. So I grew up in the 80s and 90s. I'm used to that. That's like a minority pet, you know, remember? That was blacks and Latinos exclusively. So there was a different type of presentation back in the day. Like the dog, you know, they would clip the ears, clip the tail. Dog looked like it just escaped from a group home or something. The owner, he might have been a drug dealer. He might have just got out of prison. He definitely had a wife beater on, you know. And they would have the dog on like a thick metal chain and just hold it tight and walk it like he was taking it to court, like it was serious, you know, like. Because that was the animal equivalent of a thug back in the day, you know. Nowadays, it's a whole new presentation. You got 90-pound white women in yoga pants being dragged by pit bulls on extender leashes. If you know anything about an extender leash, you know an extender leash will give a dog free rein to just run unrestricted for about half a block top speed. So now if you, me, you coming from something like this, you get home maybe 12, 1 o'clock in the morning, you walking home, you got your headphones in, and you turn the corner, and out the corner of your eye, you're like, oh shit, it's a pit bull. I was so scared, I jumped on a Corolla with one leap. I was on the top of the Corolla. I'm breathing hard. I could feel my heartbeat in my ear. I'm scared to death. And this white woman walks up on, she runs up on me with some thong sandals on, upset at me for being afraid. She's like, what are you scared of? I said, babe, that's a pit bull. What are you talking about? It's a tag dog. She looked like it was loose. She said, that's not a pit bull. That's a rescue animal. I said, huh? See, I didn't know at the moment. I didn't know the semantics. I'm like a rescue animal. I'm figuring, okay, what happened? Was this dog in a burning building? You ran in, you scooped it up, put it under your arm, you shimmied down the fire escape off to freedom. Was the dog in a shootout with a switchblade? You came through, shot up the block, put him in the passenger, just drove off. I thought it was some heroic shit, you know. Yeah, that's what it is. No, no, it's not. I did a Google search and I found out. A rescue animal, all it is a dog that has 24 to 48 hours to be adopted from the kennel or will be put to sleep. I said, wait a minute. Oh, whatever. That's not a rescue animal. That's a clearance sale. That, you got that, that's a Black Friday pit bull. Got that for the low. You didn't save any, you just saved money. That was the only thing you saved in that situation. Plus, you don't know where they're from. This dog could have been one of DMX's old pit bulls, catch a flashback. You don't know. So there's three couples in my building that have rescue animals. There's one dude on my floor, a little short white guy, about 5'4". And I think he told his dog some shit about me. I don't know, seriously. Because when I came downstairs to check my mail, he and his dog were in the lobby, and the dog looked at me, then looked at his owner, looked back at me like, is this the nigga right here? And he lunged at me. Shit was there. It was scary. He lunged at me. I'm up against the wall. I'm selectively scared, so I'm like, oh, shit, get your dog. You a sucker. I got no problems with you. Get your fucking dog. You got, hey, chill. And he saw the fear in my eyes, and he relished at it for a minute, and he was down. He was like, Thelonious. And then the dog came and healed. So now I'm against the door and I'm scared and confused. Cause I'm used to pit bulls having names with no hope, you know. Like Spliff and Terror. They named this dog after Jazz Virtuoso. That shit is crazy. Oh, man. Thinking about getting married, you know. Yeah. Thinking about it. I'm thinking about it like I'm thinking about getting in shape, you know, like I'm not doing anything about it. I would have to change my lifestyle, you know. You know, when you're married, you can't be single anymore, so for the fellas, that means there's no more random vagina, you know? You gotta take that out your diet. So I'm like, damn, you know, shit, no more random vagina. How will I feed my ego? You know, like, shit. That's ego stimulant. Anyway, I'm Damien Lemon. I gotta get out of here. Thank you so much. Thank you so much.
Stay tuned for more laughs on Access TV, live from the Gotham Comedy Club in New York City. George Gallo is taking the stage when we return. Welcome back to the Access TV presentation of Gotham Comedy Live. More laughs right now.
Oh my God, I normally don't think guys are that funny, but these guys are really funny. This next comic, you have seen him on his Road Rage comedy tour. Please give it up for George Gallo.
Whoa.
Like that shit. Okay, anyway. Sorry about that. It's great to be in New York. You guys love New York, huh? You're always on camera wherever you go in this town, isn't it right? You blow a traffic light, it's like, well, I take advantage of that shit. I earned it, right? Some of you are like, I don't know if I like this guy. That's okay, make up your own jokes, I'll just move my mouth. You know what I'm saying? Thanks. Who drove? Anybody drive here, or we all have tourists? You guys came from Jersey? Where? Jersey, Long Island. Jersey's like the new Long Island. It's like, it's all a nightmare. What are you talking about? Suburbanite shit. No one cares about anybody else. They call these safety cameras, is what they call them. But nobody cares because it's about caring. Safety is about caring, right? So when you see somebody on the side of the road and they're in distress and they're like, hey, could you please help me? What do? We're just like, fuck him, Godspeed. Right? Everyone's making up stories. My car's on fire, my kids are in the asshole. Right? When you got somewhere to go and you got shit to do and it's your day off because we all work 90 hours a fucking week because it's America and we got a fucking Democrat in the office, right? So you're fucking driving and working your balls off and you're like, I gotta get to the mall, it's my only day off, this prick's dead in the car. Hold on, Christine, I think he's there. Asshole, I hope you're fucking dead. Loser. And that's what he hears. Hasn't this country changed? This country's gotten a facelift in the past 20 years, right? It's totally different. People wearing pajamas to the fucking restaurants. Do you realize that? Fucking get with it. Do you realize the rest of the world sees America? Like, we look like a bunch of idiots to everybody. We're Kim Kardashian, we're swamp people. What the fuck? We are ripe for an invasion. Wouldn't you say so? They're like, oh, this is going to be easy. But you know what? The terrorists aren't going to invade us, the people from the Middle East. No, they're already here. It's your people doing your lawns, your hotels. The Mexicans are going to fucking kill us on the inside. They're already here. They're driving tractors. They're on radios. And at the sound of a Taco Bell, it's all going to happen. They're going to raise a flag that looks like Saddam Hussein, but it's just another Mexican guy with a big, thick mustache. And everybody's on pills, right? Come on. Everyone's on drugs, Vicodins, you know. Come on. That's America today. Everyone's afraid to face their pains, and they're medicated half the time. I just got divorced, and I can't take it. Oh, shut the fuck up. You wanted a divorce. Oh, you're right. This fucking country is nuts. People are crazy. Men are turning into bitches. Right? That's right. Wake the fuck up. Stop playing fucking PlayStation with your hand down your pants. Get in there and do what you gotta do. That ain't happening to the brothers, though. The brothers know what they're doing, man. I was just talking to Damien. Give it up for him. He's a fucking funny guy. We like all the same shit. I still got a pulse. You know what? We like chicks with big asses. We like, right? Who likes a chick with a big ass? I do. That's right. When you see a girl in New York City walking down the street, that's a show. It's like... Right? That's fucking hot. I don't want to see a girl with no ass. Hi, I starved myself for 2 weeks. Get the fuck out of here. Okay, I might as well go gay if I'm going to get something that's the same thing as me, right? I don't want the same build as me. Gay guys, stay gay. I love you too. That's awesome. More for me. That's what I say, right? Gay guys have S's in words that don't even have S's. Hi, this is Frank's. This is Todd's. My name's Eric's. I'm like, is there a fucking gas leak in here? We're gonna die! I was doing some scratching before. Music isn't even the same. We used to listen to a record back in the day. Somebody would smoke some drugs or pot or whatever, and they'd tell their friend, yo, man, go look in the mirror and say Bloody Mary. That's what they say. They smoke some crazy shit, and that's the records were interesting because they had, like, static and pops and hisses and little dust balls and shit on them, right? And then you'd play it and hear, like, a Beatles song or something, right? Everyone's like, wow, the Beatles? Who the fuck are they? And you'd hear the record or Led Zeppelin. And she's buying a stairway to heaven. Right when a record slows down, it's like, what the fuck? It's scary already. And then all of a sudden, go stare in the mirror. I'm going to do the shit now. John is dead. Paul is dead. Mojo Heisen. You know what? At the end of the day, what they should do is legalize all the shit that's on the street because this country is such in a deficit. Seriously. The only downside to that is just legalize it and tax the shit out of it. So all of you guys who are cheap won't buy this shit anymore, right? Because Americans like to sneak shit. They're like, well, I really can't smoke pot, but I'm going to... You know what? You just fucking sell it, legalize it, kill the gross national budget deficit in like 10 minutes. Everybody be happy. We can't sneak shit anymore. And it's over. And then legalize and have commercials. Little ads, you know, like familiar breakfast cereal jingles, like, it's fun to have smack, crack, and pot. Into your morning.
Morning, son.
Hey, Dad!
We recently replaced the Duracell Monkey's Folgers crystals with crack cocaine.
Guys, I'm George Gallo. I had a good time with you guys. Have a great night, huh?
Stay tuned for more laughs on Access TV. Live from the Gotham Comedy Club in New York City, Brian Scott McFadden is taking the stage when we return. Welcome back to the Access TV presentation of Gotham Comedy Live. More laughs happening right now.
Our last comic of the night, you've seen him on Letterman and Ferguson. Please give it up for Brian Scott McFadden.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. All right. Hey, what a crowd. Oh, yeah. This is awesome. Great club, great show, greatest city in the world, New York, baby. Oh, yeah. This is fantastic. It's great to be here. I love New York. Why? Well, you know, because everybody has an attitude here, even the people that are supposed to help you. I was at the airport a while back. I go up to the guy at the information booth. I said, hey, is there a bathroom around here? The guy goes, you want the closest one? What are you supposed to say to that question? No, I kind of like to drag out the discomfort as long as I can, actually. You got anything with a cab ride or a connecting flight involved? I know a lot of people think the first bathroom and comes along, but not me. I like to shop around, you know? It's that New York accent, right? That New York accent is kind of intimidating, right? That's why certain jobs won't hire you if you have a New York accent. Did you know that? Like airline pilot is a perfect example. All airline pilots have the same accent. They have a Midwest vibe, and they all, yeah, exactly. And they all sound exactly the same. The guy comes on, good afternoon, everybody. This is your pilot speaking. We're third in line for takeoff here. We got good skies ahead of us, so we're on time. Might get you in a little early today. We do have a few announcements. FAA regulations say there's no smoking on the plane. That includes the lavatory. Don't use electronic devices till we reach cruising altitude. We know you have travel options, and we do appreciate you choosing to include us in your... Including us in your travel plans here today. You got 45 years of flight experience up here in the cockpit. You're in good hands. If anything we can do to make your flight even more comfortable, don't hesitate to let us know. Now sit back and enjoy the ride. That's awesome, isn't it, right? That's right. They never hire a guy with a New York accent, right, for that show. Because I don't think it would sound nearly as soothing, you know? Yeah, how you doing, everybody? Yeah, my name is Fast Eddie. Yeah, I'll be a pilot today. If anybody's not happy about that, yeah, join the friggin' club on that one. Twenty-five years in this business, you'd think they'd start giving me some of the good routes. Anyways. You got a couple announcements here. There's no smoking on a plane. No smoking in a bathroom either. Yeah, you know why that is? It's because the bathroom is actually part of the airplane. Yeah, that seems to come as a big shock to some people. And the mere fact that I have to point that out is the reason I hate this job. Once we get in the air, you look out of the plane, you know what you're gonna see? Water. And that's where you're gonna be if anybody tries anything during my flight. I'm serious, people, I'm in no mood today. Anybody gets out of line back there, I will not hesitate to turn your weekend getaway into the Poseidon Adventure in 3 seconds. You got 22 weeks of sobriety up here in the cockpit. As we all know, it's one day at a time, people, one day at a time. We appreciate you choosing to fly with us today, even though we all know you had no other options. Are we kidding, people? There's only three airlines left, and one of them is Qantas. So is either this or ride a seahorse across the Atlantic. We're fifth in line on a runway here. So I'm gonna see if I can cut one of these guys off.
Yeah, that's not a cool accent, that New York accent. It's not like Spanish. Watch a Spanish soap opera. There's a sexy accent, right? Turn on a Spanish soap. Everybody's dramatic and cool. El puto de grafía del mundo de Trabajadoras a Peace. El filio mío de Cinco de Mayo. Mucho dinero ocupado. Feliz Navidad. Uno, dos, tres, cuatro, cinco, seis. El pollo loco, huevos rancheros. That is awesome, right? That is, right. Women love that accent, right? But women say sense of humor is more important than anything, even money or looks. Oh, yeah. What they don't say is it kind of depends on how poor and unattractive the guy with a sense of humor is. Right, ladies, there's limits to what a sense of humor will compensate for. Sense of humor's great, but if the guy's a homeless hunchback, all the knock-knock jokes in the world are not gonna help him on the dance floor. That's why men are confused about what you want, ladies, right? Men wanna please you, we wanna make you happy, but you are all over the map with what you want. And that's why whenever a man tries to figure out what a woman wants, he often looks like a cat chasing a laser pointer, if you notice, all right? You know, confused, disoriented, but strangely hopeful. But ladies, you want conflicting things in a man. You don't always acknowledge this. Women want a man who's ambitious, an achiever, who's successful both professionally and financially, who's not materialistic. Women want a man who is solid, steady, consistent, and reliable, who is fun, unpredictable, and spontaneous. Women also want a strong-willed, decisive man who takes a stand, sticks to his guns, and doesn't waver. As long as he's flexible, open-minded, and can admit when he's wrong. Anybody starting to see a pattern here? Oh, yeah. Women want a lot, you know, ladies, you do. You want a realist who's romantic. You want a guy who's serious but playful. Who's confident but humble and horny but faithful. Okay. Women want a man who's career-driven, but family-oriented. Yeah, you also want a sexy, dynamic, attractive, charismatic guy who has that special, sensual, animal quality that drives women wild. Yeah. Who's not a player. Good luck on that one, girl. Yeah. Yeah. Anything else on that list? Sure, why stop there? Let's drive this crazy train right off a cliff. You also want a guy who's smart but not nerdy, caring but not needy, affectionate but not clingy, protective but not possessive. emotional but not neurotic, funny but not a clown, dominant but not domineering, and in control but not controlling. No problem. He's right here, girls. So let's see if I have this. Write it down, guys. There you have it. We got to be strong but sensitive, tough but tender, masculine but gentle, and manly but vulnerable. Because apparently what a woman wants is a gay football coach. Mystery solved.